At the Met in 1921, the opera went down a storm. Though it had enjoyed three previous productions in New York, it was as if Gigli had created the role. "I did, in fact, identify myself with it completely," he wrote. "It ceased entirely to be make-believe. I felt it passionately. In the third act trial scene, each time I cried out the words, 'Con la mia voce ho cantato la patria,' I thought of Italy. Like Chenier, I too expressed in song the love I felt for my country." Caruso's son Enrico Jr. recorded that his father did not begrudge Gigli his well-deserved success, but it hurt him that the revival meant for him was taken by another tenor. Well, the role could hardly have been taken by a baritone, but clearly Caruso meant to imply that Andrea Chenier should have been replaced with another show. However, cancelling all Caruso's operas was not an option likely to appeal to Met general manager Giulio Gatti-Casazza. Enrico Jr. also recalled his father remarking, on hearing of the performance, "Potevo almeno aspettare che fossi morto." At least he could have waited until I was dead. So at the end of the season, Gatti-Casazza offered Gigli another one-year contract. Gigli frankly admitted that financial advantage and prestige were compelling enough reasons to accept, though there were other considerations. The Met was a polyglot company numbering 14 nationalities amongst its roster of artists, but Italian seemed to be the official language, so Gigli felt at home in the house. Artistically, the productions were the best in the world. They offered great opportunities, and the management and public expected great performances in return. "Finally," Gigli wrote, "I liked the idea of spending a large part of the year with the same company, under the same artistic guidance, and in the same place. No European opera house was in a position to offer so much security. With fewer extraneous irritants, I could sing better. With fewer trains to catch, fewer suitcases to pack, I could at last enjoy some domestic peace." Except, of course, that Gigli didn't have his family with him. He hadn't seen them for over a year. The lot of an international singer's wife in the 1920s was like that of a sailor's wife. Months of absence followed by a few highly pressurised days or weeks of intense togetherness before the wilderness of the next long absence. It was not the recipe for a happy marriage. So Gigli wrote to his wife Costanza, asking her to find servants, pack trunks, and bring the family to New York. After spending the summer of 1921 fulfilling engagements in South America, Gigli approached the beginning of the 1922 season with some trepidation. This might have been occasioned by the prospect of installing Costanza, who'd never been abroad before or had any servants to instruct, into the grand surroundings of the rented apartment at 140 West 57th Street near Carnegie Hall. In fact, Gigli's apprehension was caused by a New York newspaper headline, "Who will become Caruso's successor?" Caruso had died in Naples on August the 2nd. It's true that now as then, the music world is fond of speculation as to who will be the next great tenor. It's a process from which baritones and basses seem to be exempt. But debates about who will be the next Pavarotti, Domingo or Carreras are not conducted on the front pages of the daily newspapers. Gigli found the whole affair irreverent, macabre and unnecessary. "It seemed absurd to talk as though he had founded a dynasty," he railed, "as though Caruso II would now have to be chosen, crowned and anointed with holy oils." Gatti-Casazza was needled into doing something he hated, giving an interview to the press. "There are but two elements, public opinion and time, which can decide who will be the successor or successors to the great artist," he stated flatly, in an attempt to calm things down. "The modern theatre has ceased to be a theatre of stars and has become a theatre of the tout ensemble. What we aim at is a perfectly rounded production." Gatti's intervention was to no avail. Gigli noted how embarrassing it was to bump into tenor colleagues in the corridors of the Met, people like Martinelli or Pertile, when their respective merits and demerits were being thrashed out over the papers at breakfast tables all over New York and beyond. He took the unprecedented step of writing to the New York Times. "I believe that to speak of this at present, or in any way to mention Caruso's successor, is a sacrilege and a profanity to his memory. It means violating a tomb which is sacred to Italy and the entire world. The efforts of every artist today aim to gather and conserve the artistic heritage received from the great singer, and everyone must strive to do this. not with vain self-advertisement, but with tenacious study for the triumph of the pure and the beautiful. He struggled for this, and we, for the glory of our art, must follow his example with dignity. But reporters continued to badger Gigli. "I don't want to be another Caruso," he told them. "I just want to be Gigli." But the issue was a live one, because the opening night of the Met season was looming. Since 1903, on every opening night but one, the privilege of inaugurating the season had been granted to Enrico Caruso. As Gigli eventually realised, Gatti Cosazza had come up with a shrewd and tactful solution. On November the 14th, the curtain went up on a soprano's opera. The spotlight was on the Met debut of Amelita Galicurci in Verdi's La Traviata. Gigli, of course, was cast as the hot-headed and generally disliked romantic lead, Alfredo. But as regards his performance, the heat was off.